there's a lot to be said about Action 1000. Just the number alone and the fact that it's the first superhero book to reach that number is a testament to the character's strength and endurance.
1,000 issues is actually very impressive when you think of perhaps 12 issues per year. That's a long run. That's a lot of people's fathers, grandfathers.
Very few people can even remember a time there wasn't a Superman. Unless you're over 90, there's no such thing as a world without Superman.
I think it just speaks to the wish fulfillment of superheroes, right? We wish that there was a character looking over us in the inner cities, that there was someone that could make things right, and that they almost existed outside the normal rules that we all had to live by, and they would always make the right decisions. Superman, because he was a character that fought for the ultimate good and against injustice, and the fact that he actually did come from another planet, made him almost an impartial kind of judge, someone that could provide a perspective that wasn't tainted like the rest of us.
1000 is full of characters who could be Superman's first cousin. There was Doc Savage, who was even called a Superman once in a while, and the Shadow was the first cousin. There was Conan in the pulps. Nobody ever came close to our Superman, because I think what happened was the character evolved, which it had to do if it wanted to last.
This is a job for Superman.
Action 1000 exists and gets to 1000 because of Superman. No other reason. Simple as that. He's in every issue. He's in every story. He's on the covers. He's the one driving the sales. He's the one driving the interest. He's the one that's doing it. So the success of Superman is really where Action 1000 comes from.
Within the first year of Superman's debut, there started to be scores of imitators, what they used to call Long John characters, right? Because of the tights. It all stemmed from Superman. He gave birth to our modern mythology.
Superman has legs. He was created during the 1930s, during the Depression. He morphed during the 50s to a different kind of Superman, Superman more aimed at children. And then through the 60s with social consciousness, and through the 70s and 80s and 90s, and now into the culture of diversity. The character itself is so multifaceted that he actually is very adaptable to and interacts with the culture that surrounds him at any given time.
The actual marking of 1,000 issues is pretty impressive because, number one, there's no point where it didn't sell well enough to continue, which is an affirmation that the character has been commercially viable for 80 years plus. But beyond that, you've also got a lot of decades worth of kids who read and love Superman.
I love the fact that he is always trying to do the right thing, that he is an example. He is something to aspire to. That's what touches me about the character. As a kid, you know, I had the costumes. I remember my uncle holding me up and flying me around in my Superman costume, and I had the action figures. And I think there's a part of the character that people, kids, just are drawn to because that's, they want to be like that.
In Cleveland, Ohio, two Jewish kids got together and they wanted to do a comic strip about a villain who comes from another planet, and he's a Superman. They sent it to the syndicates, and the syndicates turned them down. They said, why don't we make him into a hero? Well, now we're gonna have a hero be called Superman instead of a villain.
He was always someone who stood up for the right thing. That's not something that I think goes out of style.
Let me explain how this is gonna go.
Anyone else care to educate me?
I want my heroes to be good. I want them to be inclusive. I want them to be all of the things that Superman is.
I think that Jerry Siegel had an instinct for how to do this work. I mean, nobody knew how to do comics because there had not been any original comics to speak of before Bill Gaines bought Superman from Joe and Jerry.
This guy at DC Comics decided that he would publish these young guys' comic book story, even though it was not like all the other cowboys and detectives. It was about a guy who came from another planet. Who would be interested in that? Apparently, everybody.
The country had gone through 10 years or thereabouts of pretty grim poverty. And we were looking for something that was optimistic. Joe and Jerry, I think, were mostly blue-collar kids who were reacting to what was in the air. The world was looking for heroes. The world was tired of being grim. They were ready for red, white, and blue optimism.
Look, up in the sky, it's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman.
Superman has those primary colors, red and blue and a little bit of yellow. So right away your eye is attracted to the character. It goes right to your gut, especially if you first experienced Superman as a kid, you know?
I grew up in Seoul, South Korea, and I remember watching the Max Fleischer cartoons, and I think that was probably the first superhero I saw and reacted to. And then what was really cool is I came to America with my family, and Superman was here too. So it was kind of nice to have that connectivity, and I'm sure it was somewhat emotionally comforting that the stuff that I grew up with was also in this new kind of strange land that we moved into.
Got a minute?
What do you want?
Batman walks into a bar, everybody runs and hides, because they're afraid of what Batman might do. Superman walks into a bar. Everybody wants to be his friend and buy him a drink.
Say, Superman!
Superman!
He's the most powerful character in the world, and yet everybody feels so comfortable that they can walk up and say hello to him.
He has these enormous powers, and he uses them altruistically. It makes him a hero for all time.
Here's a guy who is extremely powerful, and in any other kind of, even a comic book situation, he would be a villain, or people would maybe be afraid of him. But because he's pure, because he's good, people trust him. And that's why I always felt like it was a character who could smile. Because if he was scowling, he might give people reason to be a little afraid.
He uses his power for good, and he tries to do the right thing. So I think that's the inspirational thing, that he is the most pure expression of human potential, even though he's an alien.
His dynamic, as he's characterized with the other DC heroes, is and should always be as the voice of reason, the voice of temperance, the grown-up in the room, probably more than any other character in the core DC pantheon.
We face a threat big enough to wipe us off the earth, and still we bicker about a mask or a uniform. My best friend is lying upstairs right now. She would have given her life for this country, and I can hardly look her in the eye. America was founded on the notion that a person should be free to follow his or her destiny. But we can't do that if we're living in fear of our own government. We need to reclaim this country for free men and women everywhere.
He is always thinking about other people, sometimes to the detriment of thinking of himself, but that's where good stories lie.
I didn't have the best childhood growing up. I was raised by my grandparents, and my parents were not very involved, and there was a lot of conflict and whatever. And Superman as a character, just, it was hope. It was, your parents are always telling you do the right thing, but when you're seeing something that you admire, you look up to doing that, it reinforces that. It makes it seem like it's okay. Superman really is, I believe, a positive role model.
Because his power is limitless, his ability to help is limitless. He's really gonna be able to strive and help in any way humanly possible or superhumanly possible. And what that does is sets a standard for yourself. So you can do your own self-exploration. What's my limit? And how can I help to that limit? Or maybe push myself a little bit further if I want to help even more. So it makes people want to try and achieve more in ways that make themselves more beneficial to the people around them.
I'd hope that kids reading these things when they were kids would be inspired to maybe be working for Greenpeace or environmental crusades and such, because that stuff always inspired me that way.
I was posted in the Scientific American recently a study by some psychologists, and there were two control groups, and one was sent into a room where there was a poster of Superman. The other was sent into a room where there was like a picture of a bicycle. Both groups were tested afterwards, and the Superman group tested remarkably higher in altruism. So just seeing Superman makes people want to be better.
The roots of the character are tied into history, right? I mean, he was a social warrior in the earliest incarnation of the character.
Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster were two Depression-era kids in 1933 when they first thought of the concept. Like other Jewish kids in America, they knew what was going on in Europe. They knew about the Holocaust. They knew about the death camps and the Nazis. And they felt powerless to do anything about it.
Jerry's father owned a clothing store in Cleveland. And the store was robbed. In the aftermath of the robbery, he had a heart attack. And if he didn't die immediately, then shortly thereafter. There's a theory that kind of Jerry's response to that was to come up with this character who couldn't be harmed, who would survive any assault and any crisis.
I think that what we're seeing in the Superman story, in his origin story, a baby put into a rocket and being sent to a new world where hopefully he'll have a good life, it's a story of immigration, it's a story of immigrant culture.
He's essentially someone from somewhere else, and it becomes a metaphor for the obstacles of prejudice and being an alien in all senses of the word that an immigrant faces.
No matter how much good we do, deep down, people are always going to be scared of us.
And I think there was probably some of that channeled by Jerry Siegel of his own family's experience being immigrants coming to America and sort of having to make their way. You know, at the same time, wanting a character who, you know, would not be a victim of Hitler, who would not be a victim of prejudice, but who would, you know, represent goodness and righteousness and not giving in to bullies.
The eugenics movement was really big in the 20s, right? So this idea of a Superman view, that there was perhaps genetic underpinnings to creating people that were physically superior to others. So there's a lot of things in the zeitgeist, I think, that led these kids to kind of absorb it all.
Before this, unless you go back to ancient Greece and ancient Rome, there were no supermen. There were gods and demigods, pseudo-gods, but there were no men who were super. This is the first. Within 3 months, they were selling 1 million copies. Newsstand dealers were calling DC Comics saying, send more, as many of these as you can send, send them. That began the whole idea of having superheroes in comic books. It became a genre. It became a thing. The publishers who were printing and reprinting this other stuff turned to their artists and writers and said, see what those guys are doing? Do that. Give me a superhero. I want a superhero.
Superman. The War Department goes on to say that during this action, an entire fleet of Axis submarines was destroyed by American dive bombers. affording the troop ships a safe crossing.
There is one person on this planet right now who owns a PhD in comic books. That's Mike Uslan, who has produced all the Batman movies since 89. He taught a four-credit course. The way he tells it is he was pitching his course to the professors, and nobody was in comic books. And he said, a kid is orphaned, he's put in a basket, and he's sent down the river, and he is rescued. And they said, yeah, that's the Moses story. And Mike said, and that's the Superman story. He, you know, completely convinced them.
I think in the early 70s, maybe there was a book called The Bible According to Superman or something. And I remember thinking, huh, does that work? For me, Superman was never a god. And I think as a character would be aghast to be thought of as a god because he was raised as a human.
He's got the powers of a god, but doesn't choose to set himself up as a god.
There is something that is probably in our genomes about wanting to identify with very, very powerful characters, with people who could save us. Every culture eventually evolves a super god, a Zeus, an Odin, somebody who is supremely powerful.
As the founder of a mythology, Superman is culturally extremely important. He's an American myth invented in the American century.
There is a lot of that sense of Americana with Superman.
I think Superman and superheroes in general are very intertwined with Americana just because of the three contributions of America to the world, right? Jazz, baseball, and comic books. And so are superheroes.
Every kid I knew carried a comic book in his back pocket so he could trade it with his friend. That's how we got to read all the comic books. We couldn't all afford to buy all these comic books. We bought one comic book a month. We carried them around in our back pocket, and when we ran into our friend, we had read our comic book, and we traded with that other kid, and we got another comic book, and then we traded with somebody else. And pretty soon in that month, we got to read all the comic books because we traded comic books. That was my literature.
But I think as superheroes and Superman became more popular and embraced by the entire world, I think it'd probably be a little short-sighted or selfish to say, well, he only represents the good, you know, red, white, and blue. I think he stands for the best virtues of America, and I think that's something to be applauded and embraced, right? It's about freedom, it's about democracy, it's about self-determination.
I mean, Superman is a quintessentially American myth. The love for Superman in other countries is huge. I think that's because the core of the American myth isn't really American. It's something everybody wants. But Superman is the embodiment of our highest national ideals.
He's always getting out there and helping people that can't help themselves. I think that speaks to the American way. I think that's, you know, what Americans like to think that we are.
His heroism for us, the way we view him, is more aspirational than reality. I think if we could try to be like a representative of truth and justice, that would make for a wonderful America. And I think it is the America that we aspire to, but sometimes don't quite come as near to as we would like. But, you know, like Superman, we get up and we pick ourselves up and we take another crack at it.
You can't touch me. We're on American soil now. And I am the president.
Consider yourself impeached.
To keep Superman fresh is something we're constantly challenged with, because he does represent a very clear idealism that it sometimes might feel antiquated or out of step with society. What we have to do is to show that his ideals to help people, his belief in others, that self-sacrifice can never go out of style, should never go out of style. And we've always got to create challenges for him that challenges those beliefs and show why they're just as relevant today as they were when they were first created and written in him when the character was created 80 years ago.
You know, if there's one thing I can't stand, it's a bully.
Superman the Man of Steel, number 80. Superman, who up to this point has been sort of a man of mystery, has to step out of the shadows and become a public figure in order to stop the American Nazis from using him as propaganda. So he lands at a Nazi rally in Central Park, and he smashes a giant swastika in classic Golden Age fashion, and then he turns around, he addresses the crowd, and he tells them what's up. And he has this lovely speech in there, which I have come to think of as the Superman Manifesto. I just like that. I like that moment. It sort of encapsulates and crystallizes who Superman is.
The costume is very basic. It's a fun costume to draw. There's no complications, extra piping and, you know, anything adorning it. It's a guy who can wear a costume like a Greek statue.
One of the interesting things that I don't think a lot of people really recognize is that Superman is one of only a few characters that you know it's Superman whether you're looking at him in front or back, because his logo is on his cape. Only a few characters are like that.
Superman.
You know, every creator is standing on the shoulders of the creators that came before them, and you're all trying to, you know, one up the quality of the work that was done and add new elements to the mythology to make it contemporary and vibrant and appeal to new generations of readers.
There is a certain ideal expectation and a physicality that this character does. And if you follow the history of the character, a little bit has to do with the fact that for the first 40 years of his existence, it was very limited in the number of artists. You had the Siegel and Shuster style, you had Wayne Boring in the 50s, then you had Kurt Swan in the 60s into the 70s, really. And it's not until you hit the 80s that you really start to experiment with the look of who Superman is. You had a very consistent interpretation, and therefore when other artists come in, they can't really interpret them as widely as you do Batman.
Well?
I think there have been two key artists that really have influenced the look of Superman. One is Kurt Swan. He drew a very classic Superman, Norman Rockwell-esque. And then Neil Adams is the other one. I think he was the first modern era artist that made Superman look like he could be a real person in tights that could fly through the sun.
I'm an educated artist. I'm a professional. I study my work. I do my work and I study my work and I constantly try to improve. We've come into a time where more and more artists have to learn anatomy, have to learn perspective, have to learn skills that make their craft.
Brought a level of realism to the character that didn't exist before, in my opinion. I think I was influenced by Neil. I tried to incorporate maybe more shadows into the character, which I think a lot of people hadn't done before. He's, you know, usually considered a light character, shining, the ability to shine hope. And I wanted to bring a little more realism and shadows, kind of plant Superman within the world that we live in.
You're living in a dream world!
Good. Dreams save us. Dreams lift us up and transform us into something better. And on my soul, I swear that until my dream of a world where dignity, honor, and justice are the reality we all share, I'll never stop fighting. Ever.
I think that's what was really celebrated in Action 1000. It was really celebrating everything that makes Superman great that we've seen over the years. And one of the things that we had the most fun with is where we did the decade covers. We did variant covers based off of every decade to really capture the flavor of that period of time. In the course of the covers alone, we showed how Superman evolved from the 30s into the new millennia.
Joe Shuster is a co-creator, and certainly Jack Kirby in that short stint on Superman with Jimmy Olsen and Christopher Reeve were the strongest visual inspirations for me. Those were the ones I tried to kind of impart some of that bigness. And that helps with a character like that. It helps also when you're drawing a Clark Kent, standing kind of maybe a little more slumpy and a little slouchy, and you have a Superman character who is pumped up. People would even feel like, oh, these can't be the same person. You would just not, it wouldn't occur to you, you know.
But with him around, you're a parody of a man. A dullard, a cripple. Next to Superman, even Lex Luthor's greatness is overshadowed.
We, and anybody who's watching this and doesn't agree with me, is lying, okay? We know we're Clark Kent. But inside of us, we think there's a Superman. And if a moment came that we could show that, we would love to be able to show that so that people would look at us just a little bit more admiringly.
Mr. Kent, I'm really very glad you're well again, but I'm not so sure it's much of an improvement.
I think in the 80s and 90s, when Mike Carlin came on board the books, a previous generation of editors and writers had thought of Superman more as an alien, and Clark Kent as a disguise, bumbling, goofy Clark Kent as a disguise of this godlike alien who comes from space, and this is how he thinks of humans.
You showed plenty of courage getting that monster story, Lois.
Thanks, but where were you?
Me? Oh, I must have fainted.
By the time it was our turn, people and fans had found that that made him less relatable. And so part of our job was to correct the alien-earthling balance there.
I don't think of Superman as being the lead character in the Superman saga. Clark Kent, to me, is equal to, if not superior, in that he's the creature that walks among us. He's the alien that walks among us and pretends to be us.
I think that the psychological dynamic of double identity characters, beginning maybe with the Scarlet Pimpernel in the 17th century, was a kind of wish fulfillment. The girl that just dumped me thinks I'm a skinny loser. We know that underneath this skinny exterior is a hero. And I think that was where Superman and Clark Kent started. Clark Kent was this guy with glasses, and you know, in a cocktail party, he would be hiding in the corner and drinking Coke. As a kind of card-carrying wimp myself, that appeals to me. I think the appeal is I can fantasize that underneath this wimpy exterior is a Superman.
My favorite thing about Clark Kent is that traditionally, he likes to make out that he's incompetent and weak-willed and indecisive and cowardly.
I've always liked you, Kent. You're humble, modest, comically uncoordinated, human. In short, you're everything he's not.
But he's a reporter who always gets the story. He scoops everybody.
Clark Kent should never be overlooked. I think he is the core of Superman. Unlike Batman, where Bruce Wayne is the veneer, he's the mask that Batman hides behind, I think it's the complete opposite. Superman's the secret identity to Clark Kent, who, you know, this kid from the Midwest that grew up with the values that his parents imbued upon him. Clark is the moral center that guides Superman.
You can imagine that Lois sits there and thinks that Clark wishes he were Superman. But of course he is.
The big key to me always was that this is a character who found out about his heritage kind of after the fact. You know, I mean, it's a little bit of a mind-blowing kind of aspect to think, well, wait, I'm from another planet?
Clark's personality doesn't change when he becomes Superman. They are the same man.
I'm not impersonating Clark Kent. I am Clark Kent.
If Clark is awkward, he's awkward because he's awkward, you know? He doesn't put it on as a mockery of what humans are like. He's, you know, he's a big farm boy.
I was aware of your lumbering presence, Kent.
I think just reading comics or any mythology that's been around for 80 years, there's a bit of a mind game that you have to play, which is, you know that this character's been around since the Great Depression or post-Great Depression. He fought in World War II. He existed in all this history, but at the same time, he can't have because, you know, he has to exist in our world. People know of these characters and their vast histories, but I also have to write something that's pertinent and relatively self-contained in the here and now.
I mean, he started faster than a speeding bullet, able to leap tall buildings in a single bound. Pretty soon he could look through walls. And pretty soon after that, because of the way that Joe drew him, he could fly. Because when Joe drew him jumping over those tall buildings, he looked like he was flying. So when nobody was much noticing, they just, you know, gave him that power. The point of all this is he was allowed to change with the times. Nobody had a real firm idea of what Superman had to be.
In Superman's very first appearance, he took on domestic violence. He took on arms dealers, the people who profit off of war. So he took on real issues of the day. It's impossible to do Superman without occasionally treading into that realm because it's fundamental to the premise.
I help wherever I'm needed.
What would I do in the world if I could do this?
In other words, the radiation from the approaching meteor is affecting Superman's mind. He's a danger to us all now, and himself as well. In accordance with that, I am announcing a bounty on him in the amount of $1 billion.
One of my favorite lines from a song in that era was, "You can steal more money with a briefcase than you can with a gun." And that reflects the 80s, you know, and certainly the 90s, the same thing. You had a lot of stock market ups and downs and a lot of, you know, fly-by-night corporations and things like that. That was at least our inspiration for making it different at that time.
I guess my favorite theme was inclusion. I may be back before inclusion even had a name. I had a young friend who was one of my daughter's friends, actually, who lived over in the projects in Manhattan and said to me, "Why are there no superheroes that look like me?" And I thought, gosh, John, you're right. And at that point, because of John, because of, you know, this kid, this fan, I was able to use, I guess, my books to try to be more inclusive. Inclusive racially, religiously, gender-wise, age-wise. I tried to do stories that reflected what the world around me looked like.
Throughout Superman's history, there have been different periods of whether Ma and Pa Kent were alive or passed. I think that it's one of the great things that John Byrne did when he relaunched the character back in the 80s was that he kept Ma and Pa Kent alive. It was a great source of material for us doing the stories to have him grounded that way, a way of showing through his interactions with his parents who he was. We could see that relationship and how that affected him becoming who he is.
To me, the strongest thing that the Kents do really with Superman is they give him a loving environment and they treat him like a normal kid. He knew he was different. I would imagine if you looked at it from like a real life point of view, you would realize maybe you're different than somebody else. But they created a normal environment for him. They tried to protect him. They gave him his humanity.
Dad, come on, TMI.
What's that mean?
Too much information, Jonathan. I'm sure Lois has heard half these stories before.
Not really.
And I think Jimmy Olsen and Lois Lane and any of the characters he interacts with also give him a chance to be human.
Lois is, she's smart, she's brave, she's tough, and she's tenacious. She's like a bulldog with a stray. When she gets an idea, she's gonna follow it to the end and see where it goes. You know, you can't stop her. In a way, she's as unstoppable as Superman. She always has been.
You have to stop doing things like that.
No, what I have to do is get the story.
Other reporters do their jobs without needing me to save them every time.
Other reporters don't have the access I do.
To the stories or to me?
Both. Must be awful being you. Most powerful man in the world, and you still can't control the women in your life.
I think someone as strong as Superman, having a female counterpart that is a strong character as well, is the only way you could have it. Somebody that can stand up to him, but is also capable of loving him.
Lois, as much as any of the characters, reflects the society, and certainly the woman's place in society that she's played against.
But I think she is able to look at him and cut through all of the intimidation potential there of this indestructible guy with all these powers, and somehow she sees the human that is in the alien.
Everybody.
Two.
What happened to camera on the action? The story's that way.
Jimmy Olsen is the kid. He's almost like the naive us. I think for him, Superman and Clark, too, are kind of father figures. They show him the guy he wants to grow up to be. And maybe, you know, maybe he speaks for us that way.
A monster's heading towards Metropolis. He's already taken out half the Justice League.
Well, I guess he must have heard. That.
When we took over the books, it was what fans now refer to as
the Dark Age of comics.
Vengeance-based fantasy was kind of king at the time. And here was this stable of creators, writers and artists, under Mike Carlin, who were doing these amazingly good Superman stories that was really bringing Superman back to his core concepts. And people weren't really paying attention because that wasn't the mood of the country.
My friend Jerry, who was part of the overall large Superman team, said, let's kill him. Now, Jerry would say this every year, and we'd say, ha, 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 yeah, Jerry, let's get real. This year we said, hey, Jerry, that's not a bad idea.
When he said that, it's like he always had, you know, let's just kill him. Mike Carlin's response, instead of laughing it off, was, okay, then what?
The goal was always to show how he interacts and how people see him. So that when he was gone, you would be able to say, we miss him. That happened in real life as well with the fan reaction and non-fan reaction. Oh my, how could you take Superman away from us? That was kind of the point in a way of the story, was to show how much he meant to people. Even if you didn't think that, or if you weren't thinking of it at the time, how big this character was and how much of an icon and, you know, again, something that you, a character you'd look up to, you would miss him when he's gone.
It was successful beyond our wildest dreams. It became this huge event around the world, which surprised me, certainly. And I think it surprised a lot of people.
If Superman can die, what does that mean for everything? What does that mean for truth, justice, and the American way? People really woke up. And of course, you know, they bought millions and millions of copies of this comic book and slabbed them and put them in Mylar and all this kind of stuff. But they also read them. And they started to read everything we put out.
I think in doing it, the way that we handled it, especially the funeral for a friend aspect of it, where we got to delve into how Superman's death affected the world by showing how it affected the world within the comics. Supporting characters and the people in the comic book. It was a reflection of what, you know, how people were reacting in the real world to him not being there. People started to think about, you know, they took Superman for granted for a long time. Superman was not a top-selling book, unfortunately. And a lot of people would say, well, why are you killing him? And it's like, well, when was the last time you bought a Superman comic book? And so this kind of made him relevant, and it was something new and different, and we did it with a sincerity, I think, that resonated with the fans.
To be part of Action 1000, especially being a longtime comic fan, is really a special moment, because I remember when the 500th issue hit the stands, the 600th, and I've seen all those milestones and all those great bits, and to participate, to help create that book and to bring in the talent was a special moment for us.
It was wonderful. It was wonderful doing another Superman story. It was like stepping back into the 1990s. I had never worked with Jerry before, and I loved what he did.
People have lifespans. A comic book creation has no real lifespan. It's as long as people are interested. Maybe Superman will be around in 200 years. You know, a politician or a social leader or somebody that people look up to has a lifespan. And they're remembered in the past tense. Superman's always remembered in the present tense.
There's no single process that creates the content. Sometimes it's the creators saying, hey, I've got this amazing idea for Superman. Brian Bendis comes in and says, hey, this is the character I want to work on. It's my first character at DC. I want to do this, this, and this. And we're like, that's fantastic. That's great. We love having these ideas and this energy. Then you have stuff like the New 52, which was editorially driven, where we sat down and said, look, might be time to do a relaunch of the universe. What does that mean? And what does that mean to our flagship character? And what can we do to Superman that changes things and refreshes the character without violating some of the things that really define who he is? Those are the kinds of conversations that we have internally and externally with our talent.
The great news for us right now is that we have an extraordinarily talented writer in Brian Bendis coming on board to really take up the mantle of Superman post Action 1000. And it really is his interpretation of the character. And he likes to tell the story about it. He, as a Jewish kid from Cleveland, came from a lot of the same roots that Siegel and Schuster came from. He understands the origins of the creators to make this character and is bringing some of those sensibilities to Superman himself. But it really is with an eye to the future. In our jobs, you know, we're here almost in a custodial manner to make sure these characters continue on.
Everyone recognizes that this character has existed for 81 years. You know, we can all accept the fact that there are multiple different versions of how you can portray this character. And we certainly allow that freedom, I think, in our creative talent when they come in and pitch a Superman idea. I think they all try to draw upon different roots of the character and create something new to kind of push that mythology going forward. But they can draw upon literally 81 years of history, which is a really nice thing to be able to do.
The napkin, that Bibbo's. What was your last secret?
I love you.
Clark.
For me, Superman was a job. And like comics, it was a job I was happy to have. And it was a real challenge. And one of the things I always tell students is, you owe yourself a decent life. Give yourself a good life. And for me, being a comic book guy was the best life I could imagine.
I spent my whole life either reading or watching or helping create superhero stories. And Superman is, you know, the touchstone you go back to. He was the first one to put all the ingredients together, the costume, the superpowers, the secret identity.
I think that in the future, Superman will do what he's done in the past, reflect the best of the society that surrounds him. I think that's his job, to be in kind of a loop with the world that the readers are experiencing and in a way mirror the best that world can produce. If he can keep doing that, I think he's a character who will last forever.
Superman, what's inspiring in the challenge, I want to be honest, as creators within the company, is to understand that this character is constantly meeting the challenges of the world, but with the perspective that he's there to help everyone, not just anybody. And he is a uniter, not a divider. And I think that's very important to today's society, is showing a character that pulls people together rather than drives them apart.
There is a Superman that lives in the hearts and minds of people, sort of a populist conception of Superman. This is the Superman that people always kind of wanted to know was somewhere safe, so when they heard he was dying, they freaked out. Superman is part of us as Earthlings, not just as Americans, but as Earthlings. There's something so fundamentally human, so fundamentally Earthling about him, that he's everywhere. And this is the sign of a really, really powerful myth, because, you know, he's outgrown his makers. Superman lives.
Up in the sky, look!
It's a bird!
It's a plane! It's Superman!
We'll be right back.